Let us start with recapitulating what we did in today morning's lecture on quantum mechanics. We discussed that in Young's double slit experiment, we cannot determine from which slit the electron goes and simultaneously observe the interference pattern. Whenever we try to observe electrons, it will perturb the experiment enough to destroy the pattern. So, this is what we discussed in the morning lecture. If we see the interference pattern, we may not be able to say how electrons reach the screen. Particles tend to behave mysteriously when they are as tiny as fundamental particles. Then we started looking at new equations which can describe the behavior of a particle which has an observable wave character. And we started trying this particular equation, which is generally known as a wave equation. Electromagnetic waves satisfy this particular equation. So, we said let us just try to look at this particular equation and see whether this can work for us. Okay, we will soon realize that it does not work because it requires certain modifications, and that is what I am going to tell you. What we did, we initially just put various type of waveforms in this particular equation and just showed that this is a, those happen to be solution of this thing. Now, let us go a little ahead this particular thing. And let us talk of something which is very important concept when we try to describe our things. That is about the superposition of waves. See, whenever we are talking of interference pattern, okay, you remember you are talking of two waves which come and superimpose on each other, and that is why there is an interference, and therefore you get either destructive or constructive interference. Essentially, when we are trying to make a wave packet, we are trying to take a large number of ideal waves and then we are superimposing on them. So, that eventually that leads to a wave packet. What I want to say that superposition is actually a very, very inherent part, very, very important part of these wave theories that we have been talking. It means there is a particular wave and there is another wave. These two waves, if they want to interfere, then actually our psi should be equal to psi 1 plus psi 2. They must be able to superimpose on each other. If they are not able to superimpose, okay, then in principle, if one wave goes one particular way, another wave goes another way, they will not interfere, they will just keep on going exactly in the same direction. Now, this superposition of waves should be inherent in your equation, because once we say that the wave equation governs the waves, let us say electromagnetic waves, then superposition principle should be built in that particular wave. So, this is something which I want to describe now. So, let us just read. We know that electromagnetic waves, even of different wavelengths, superimpose. I mean, we get beats when the wavelengths are different. If we say that the wave equation is the wave governing the electromagnetic waves, it implies that superposition should also be allowed by the wave equation. What it means that if there is a solution psi 1 of wave equation, which we have seen that psi 1 of the form of A cos kx minus omega t or sin kx minus omega t is indeed a part, a solution of this particular wave equation, then and psi 2 is another equation with, let us say, slightly different value of k, or slightly different value of omega, or slightly different value of amplitude or whatever it is, then psi 1 plus psi 2 must also be a solution of this equation. If that does not happen to be solution of this particular equation, it means this particular wave equation is not allowing superposition. If it is not allowing superposition, it means I will never get interference, I will never get diffraction, because all these things are based on the fact that if there is a disturbance which is given by psi 1, another disturbance which is given by psi 2, then psi 1 plus psi 2 is also a disturbance. Therefore, I can add these terms, and once I can add these terms, then I can find out where there will be interference, constructive interference, where there will be destructive interference, where the amplitude will be large, whether the amplitude will be smaller. Okay, that is inherent in this equation, that psi 1 plus psi 2, or in general to be say A psi 1 plus B psi 2 is also a solution of this particular equation. Should also be a solution of this particular wave equation. So, let us first show that this is really true for this particular wave equation and the electromagnetic waves. So, I am going to the next transparency. If psi 1 and psi 2 are solutions of the wave equation, psi 1 plus psi 2 should also be a solution of the wave equation. Let us verify, because this is actually a key of to interference. This is key to formation of wave packet, because wave packet can form only when I am able to superimpose these two disturbances or multiple disturbances for that matter. So, let us assume that psi 1 and psi 2 are solutions of the same equation, of the wave equation. It means psi 1 satisfies this equation, psi 2 also satisfies this equation. It means d 2 psi 1 dx square is equal to 1 upon c square d 2 psi 1 dt square, and because psi 2 is also a solution, so we must have d 2 psi 2 upon dx square is equal to 1 upon c square d 2 psi 2 dt square. Now, what I will do, I will just add these two equations and show that psi 1 plus psi 2 is also a solution to it. So, I have just added these equations, remember these were my original equations. So, I have just added, and because derivative of sum is sum of derivatives, so therefore, I can write these equations in this particular form, d 2 psi 1 plus dx square plus d 2 psi 2 plus dx square, this is I have just added. See, remember c is constant, so I have taken this c is 1 upon c square outside, so it becomes d 2 psi 1 upon dt square plus d 2 psi 2 plus dt square, and this I can write as d 2 dx square of psi 1 plus psi 2 is equal to 1 upon c square d 2 psi 1 plus psi 2 dt square. Okay. Now, you can very clearly see that psi 1 plus psi 2 is also a solution of this equation. Now, you can also see that instead of psi 1 plus psi 2, if I would have written a psi 1 plus a psi 2, this would have also been true. Then what I would have, should have done, I would have written a here and I would have written b, then there will be a here and there will be b here. This I can write as a and I can write as b here, I can write a and plus b here. So, a psi 1 plus a psi, b psi 2 will also be a solution. In general, if I have 3 waves or 4 waves or 5 waves or n waves or infinite waves, okay, they can all superimpose and they will all be solution by of this particular equation. So, this particular equation allows superposition and therefore, we can really see superposition. See, once we say that this is the equation which governs the wave nature of electromagnetic waves, then superposition should be built in this particular equation, then only superposition is possible, which we know experimentally that superposition does happen, we do get constructive and destructive interferences. Now, let us see, suppose the same equation was to represent a particle wave, whether superposition will be allowed. See, remember, in particle waves also we have seen interference. I mean, remember, when we are talking about the de Broglie wavelength, at that time we did talk that electrons can diffract. When electrons can diffract, essentially means electron waves can also superimpose. When we are talking about a wave packet being associated with a particular particle, okay, at that time also we talked that there are infinite number of waves which are superposing to create a wave packet. So, obviously, superposition has to be present in particle wave, okay, but in this case, whether superposition will be allowed or not. What I want to show that if this particular equation is governing the a wave nature of the particle, then superposition principle will not be allowed. How? Let us just look at this before we start reading this particular thing. Remember, inherent in this particular wave, that this particular wave equation is this 1 upon c square, which happens to be constant. In the case of electromagnetic waves, c is speed of light and this c is constant for both the waves. Even though the two waves may have different wavelength, may have different frequencies, but they will have the same velocity. Therefore, 1 upon c square can be taken out and therefore, it has become possible that psi 1 plus psi 2 also becomes a solution of this particular equation. But if you imagine a particle wave, particles need not travel at the speed of light. In fact, they don't travel at the speed of light. They travel at a speed which is lesser than the speed of light. And in that particular case, and of course, the wavelength, if I say that there are two particle waves which have different wavelengths, obviously, different wavelengths means different momentum by de Broglie relationship. It means their velocities would be different. So, one particular wave may have C1 here or rather V1 here. Another wave will have 1 upon V2 here. So, then in this particular thing, I will not be able to take 1 upon V square out. I will be having 1 upon V1 square plus 1 upon V2 square. Then I will not be able to write this equation in this particular form and we will see that the superposition would not be possible. So, if psi 1 is a particular wave which represents a particle of a particular wavelength, psi 2 is another wave which is representing a particle of slightly different wavelength, then psi 1 plus psi 2 will not be a solution to this particular equation. So, if this equation is to govern the wave nature of the particle, this equation will not be good enough. Remember, as I have told in the morning, we are quite a bit in dark. I have no idea. We are trying to assemble our ideas to come to an equation which is likely to represent the particle nature, rather wave nature of a particle. So, that is what I have written. If we take two particle waves corresponding to the same type of particle, for example, I am talking only one type of particles, okay, let us say electrons. Of course, we have never seen electrons interfering with neutrons, let us say. So, we are talking of always a wave of a particular particle, a of a particular type of particle. So if we have the same type of particles, for example, electron with different wavelengths, they would not superimpose if this standard wave equation was governing it. So how can we form a wave packet? Okay, we cannot work with this particular equation. We definitely need another equation. So this is basically what I am trying to say, that if they have been traveling with different speeds, then it will not be possible for us to have superposition principle valid. And remember, superposition is inherent, is built in, it has to be built in, because otherwise no interference is possible, no diffraction is possible, no wave packet formation is possible. So we do need an equation where it is possible to superimpose different waves. So how do we solve the problem? Now you realize the basic reason why we were not able to get this particular superposition is this particular thing C1, which depends on the speed of the particle. Now whatever is this particular constant which is coming in this particular equation, see, remember here you have d2 psi dx square, here you have d2 psi dt square. So you must have a constant in between, just if nothing else, at least for dimensional matching. So whatever is the constant appearing here, if that constant, it depends on any dynamical parameter, for example, momentum or energy or velocity, then we will always land up into this particular problem. So what I must do, I must have some constant here, if at all possible, which does not depend on any of the dynamical properties of this particular particle. So if this particular constant would have become independent of velocity or momentum or for that matter energy, then like here C is independent for electromagnetic waves, irrespective of its wavelength C is same, then only I am able to superimpose. Similarly, in the case of particle, if this particular constant would have been independent of speed or momentum or energy, then this particular constant could have been taken out and superposition would have been possible, which, as I say, is very, very important for us to have. So this way, say, if the constant appearing in the wave equation was not dependent on dynamical properties like speed, momentum, energy, then superposition could have been made valid. Now let us try to think of an equation where this particular superposition is possible, and whether we can have somehow a constant which is independent of these particular dynamical quantities. Let us just think a little bit about this. See, remember the equation that we had, the wave equation, was relating to del 2 psi del x square to del 2 psi del t square. Okay, there was equality sign and there was a constant. This constant I want to make independent of the dynamical properties. Now this particular psi has to be given by a raised power e I kx, or let us say sine, does not matter, minus omega t. We can even put sine, it does not matter. But what I want to essentially point it out, that, or you can take, let us say, a sin kx minus omega t, it does not matter. If I take the derivative once with respect to x, I will get k. If I take derivative twice with respect to x, I will get k square. Because once I take derivative with respect to x, I will get k first time, second time again it will get multiplied by k, so I will get k square. Once I take derivative with respect to time, I will get an omega term. If I take derivative twice, I will get omega square term. So in a normal wave equation, here I will be getting k square and here I will be getting omega square, and that is the reason omega square upon k square turned out to be the speed of light. And that is what appeared in this particular equation, which happened to be constant, as I have said, for the case of electromagnetic waves. But now I want this particular parameter not to depend on the dynamical properties, but it should depend purely on the, in the case of, I mean, purely, it should be purely a constant. Now remember, I am talking now of a massive particle, alright. When I am talking of this particular thing as a massive particle, okay, it has to obey a condition, and let us assume that it is a free particle, there is no force on it, so there is no potential energy involved. What I will realize, that k has to be equal to p square by 2m. Kinetic energy of this particular particle has to be equal to p square by 2m. Now if kinetic energy has to be equal to p square by 2m, if something appears as a square of momentum and something which appears as just a single power of k, then p square and k this will cancel it out on the two sides. What I am trying to mention is that, remember, k depends on the momentum, h cross k is momentum, and we know that h cross omega is supposed to be the energy, which in this case I am taking as kinetic energy. Once I take this particular thing, I differentiate twice with respect to time, I will get k square. If I differentiate twice with respect to x, I will get p square. That does not help me. But on the other hand, if I take second derivative here, I will get p square. If I take only the first derivative, then I will get k. So what I am suggesting is that why not try an equation which is something like this. Del 2 psi del x square, and put some constant, let us say gamma, and relate it to del psi del t. Now, what will happen when I take the second derivative with respect to x? Then in that case, here I will get k square. When I take only one time derivative with respect to psi, I will get here omega. This omega is related to energy, this is related to momentum. So I will get p square here, I will get k here, and because I know that k is equal to p square by 2m, these k will cancel, this k square will cancel with omega, and then this particular gamma will become independent of the dynamical properties. So why not try this particular type of equation, and let us try to understand whether I can reach into a better way of looking into this equation. Initially consider a non-relativistic free particle, where there is no force, there is no kinetic energy. For this particle, we have the following relationship, k is equal to p square by 2m. As I said, momentum can be related to wave vector k, while energy to omega, both involving the Planck's constant. If the second derivative with x was related to the first derivative with respect to time, things could be different. Why not try this equation? Why not try this equation where I am relating the second derivative of psi with the first derivative of t? As I have mentioned, then I will get a k square term here, so which will be p square term, and when I take derivative, I will get omega, which will be of the order of the type of k, and then p and k square will cancel, giving you just mass. So let us try this type of equation. But there is a slight problem. Our problem is that if I take the relationship as, let us say, a sin kx minus omega t, let us take this as psi. If I take second derivative with respect to x, then first time sin will become a cos, second time again cos will become sin. So you will have sin kx minus omega t here. If I take derivative with respect to time, then sin will become cos, because I am relating the first derivative to the second derivative. Here there will be cos term, here there will be a sin term. Now cos and sin term will not cancel. So we have solved one problem, but we have added one problem. Okay? I could make this particular gamma independent of dynamical properties, but then this particular solution is not at all a solution of this type of equation. Because here I will be getting sin kx, here I will be getting cos kx, okay? And they will not cancel it out, okay? Advantage in the original dynamical equation, original wave equation was that here also there was second derivative, here also there was second derivative. So sin first becomes cos, then cos again becomes sin when we take the second derivative. Here also sin becomes cos and then cos becomes sin, then sin sin term, we are cancelling it out, but now they do not cancel. But remember, instead of this term, had I taken psi is equal to a e raise to power I kx minus omega t, then I do not face this particular problem. Then what will happen? Once I take the derivative twice with respect to that, I will still get k square, but this still remains in the exponential form. When I take the derivative with respect to time for the first time, it will still remain e raise to power I kx, okay? And I will get just an omega. So an equation of this type is a solution, while this equation is not a solution, okay? Problem is that this is complex, but as I said earlier, that we do not mind things to become complex, so long the things which are actually observable, they must be real. So long they remain real, I do not mind this particular type of psi to become a complex quantity. So I will be able to get a desired equation provided I accept the fact that this particular psi, the wave that we have been assigning to a particle, is complex. It's a very, very important point for us to realize. And that's what makes quantum mechanics much more abstract and much more, you know, not easily comprehensible in that, in a standard way, especially for the undergraduate students. So I said, traditionally, when we take the Schrodinger equation, we always take the equation of this particular form. So equation has been obtained by using this type of functional form of psi. So psi is equal to A e raised to power I kx minus omega t. Advantage is that in this particular case, I could still cancel this particular term, which is the exponential term, and we could relate the second derivative of x with the first derivative of time. So now let's take psi is equal to A e raised to power I kx minus omega t. I take the first derivative with respect to time. So I will get minus I omega I out from here. Once I differentiate, it will be differential of this exponential term, which will give me the original exponential term, multiplied by differential of this particular function, I kx minus omega t. This being constant, because this is a partial derivative, I will just get minus I omega. So this minus I omega term has come. Once you take derivative with respect to x, you will get again similar thing, but you will get now I k. So instead of I omega, so you get I k. You take the second derivative, you will get minus a k square e raised power I kx minus omega t. So on the left hand side, you have got k square. On the right hand side, you have got omega. Whenever I am trying to write an equation which involves the second derivative of x with the first derivative of time, I substitute in this particular equation the original trial equation, which was this equation del 2 psi del x square is equal to gamma times del psi del t. So this is del 2 psi del x square, this is del psi del t. Okay, if I substitute this particular thing, gamma turns out to be equal to 2m upon I h cross. Of course, this gamma turns out to be a complex number. I is of course the imaginary number. Also, it depends on mass, but as I have said that we have never seen, let us say, electron beam interfering with a neutron beam. Electron beam interferes with another electron beam, and then the mass of the electron is same. Similarly, a neutron beam interferes with another neutron beam, then the mass of m, mass of the neutron, it remains same. M is mass of neutron, which is remaining identical. So therefore, I do not mind that this constant is, it contains m, but it definitely does not contain velocity, it does not contain momentum, it does not contain energy. Okay, because if they would have been contained, then I would not have been able to interfere even the electron wave, one electron wave, with a different electron wave of different wavelength. Now we go back to our original equation, and I substitute this particular equation, and this equation can be written, for gamma I have substituted 2m by I h cross, which I have just now obtained. This equation is generally written in a slightly different form. So I write this as minus, I multiplied by, I h square, which is minus h square from the both the sides. So you get minus h square, 2m comes on this side. So this becomes minus h square by 2m. And this, instead of 1 upon I h cross, becomes I h cross. So this equation becomes minus h square by 2m, del 2 psi del x square is equal to I h cross del psi del t. Important thing to realize that we are relating the second derivative of psi with the first derivative of time. Okay. This, in fact, some people had asked the question in the morning or yesterday, saying that the wave function has to be complex, and that's the reason this wave function has to be complex. But remember, the way, I mean, see, whatever we have done till the, in the quantum ideas, they were all vague ideas. Okay, they were not based on a proper theory. Okay, now this is the time when we are actually developing the proper theory. We are developing our new concepts. We are developing our new mechanics. Okay, now all the ideas that we have talked earlier should fit into this particular idea. This becomes our basic equation from which we are going to derive not only the original ideas, but more complicated problems that we are going to face in nature. Now, okay, just a few comments on this particular thing. The value of gamma indeed turned out to be independent of dynamical variables, but depends on m, which I said I do not care. Okay, remember, while obtaining this equation, I have assumed the psi to be of the form A e raised power plus I kx minus omega t. Okay. Now, that is, you remember, we have earlier mentioned that this would represent a wave traveling in plus x direction, because the direction of the motion of a wave always depends on the sign, relative sign of the x term and the omega term. Now, this is another wave which is representing a wave which is traveling in plus x direction, but in this case, I have a slightly different sign here. I have a minus sign. Now, if I would have started the wave equation taking the general equation of this particular form, my gamma would have changed sign. Okay, it does not matter. Okay, nothing would have changed in physics. Okay, but all I want to say that we always take a standard psi value in which the time dependent term is always assumed to be negative in science. Remember here, the time dependent term minus I minus omega. So, time, the coefficient of time is positive, while normally which I take the standard value of psi, this is always of this particular term where the time term is always negative. This is important to realize, because when we apply certain boundary condition in actual quantum mechanical problem, we have to remember that time dependent term is always taken of the form of minus I omega t, not plus I omega t. Otherwise, my equation that I have obtained would have been different. This equation has been obtained with a specific type of disturbance in mind, where the time dependent term is of the form of e raised power minus I omega t. In that case, the value of gamma would have been changed sign, no physics would have changed. Conventionally, we always use this type of equation, so which has time dependent term of the form of minus I omega t. The wave function turns out to be complex, but that shall not pose any problem so long the observables turn out to be real. We shall later see the physical interpretation of wave function, as we will be seeing it later, which is again, I mean, from now onwards we will realize that quantum mechanics is becoming more and more abstract. Okay. And things are not so easily comprehensible in the sense of our normal traditional classical concepts, but there is no other way of doing it. That's the way we have to do, and that's what actually makes quantum mechanics in a sense more interesting, because it essentially stretches our imagination, you know, something to something which is fairly abstract. Now we define certain quantities which are called operators. Operators are essentially very, very abstract concept, and they are defined in order to maintain the consistency with classical mechanics. I will not be able to give more details as far as this particular course is concerned, why a particular operator is defined in a particular fashion. Okay, but one can see later, I mean, if one does a course on advanced quantum mechanics, one can see that these particular operators have been defined so that eventually we have a consistency with classical mechanics, because we know classical mechanics does work for bigger particles. If I have to have a motion of a cricket ball, or if I have to motion of aeroplane, or a motion of, let's say, train or a car or a bicycle, okay, I don't require quantum mechanics. Okay, classical mechanics is good enough and gives me excellent results. Okay, so eventually this particular quantum mechanics should lead to classical mechanics in the limit of bigger particles. So if we want to maintain this consistency, these are the ways the operators have to be defined. Now, the concept of operator is fairly simple, though only the name appears to be somewhat big. For example, if I define, let's say, a sine operator, it essentially means that if it operates on, let's say, a value x, then my result is sine x. So, I will call sine as an operator, which when it operates on a quantity called x, results into a different quantity, which is now sine of x. Now, let me define some another funny operator, let us call O operator, which is, let us suppose, a square operator. Now, we define this operator, let us say, such that when it operates on any particular quantity x, my resultant is x square. So, this operator O will now be a square operator. So, basically an operator means it operates on certain things. So, we write something on the right of it. So, it operates on that particular quantity and results into something which is different from the original one. Similarly, I could define a cube operator. It if operates on x, then my result will be x cube. Okay? So, we can think of infinite type of operators. We can talk of a ddx operator when it operates on any function. Okay, then for example, ddx is also an operator. So, if it operates on, let us say, any function of x, my result is df of dx. So, all these things, this is a differential operator, this is a sine operator, this is a square operator, we can define multiple type of operators, and these operators are inherent in the quantum mechanics. They are essential parts of the quantum mechanics, and we have, once we sort of formalize quantum mechanics to a particular way, okay, then we will see that these operators are very, very essential part of the the quantum mechanics. Okay, so now without giving any reasoning, I will define certain operators. First thing that I will define is what I call as momentum operator, and to be more precise, I am calling it px operator. Okay, it is the x component of the momentum operators, and it is defined when I have written three lines here. Okay, it means this is the definition of this operator. This definition is minus I h cross del del x. It means anything which we write on the side of px, and for operator I have put this cap on this thing to realize that this is an operator and this is not anything which is simple, because for px we have also used for the x component of the momentum. Okay, so there should not be any confusion. So I have put a cap on this particular thing just to mention that this is just to sort of remind us that this is an operator and not just simple x component of momentum. So whatever is on the right hand side, this ddx operator will actually differentiate this, take a partial differentiation with respect to x, then whatever is the result, it will multiply it by minus I h cross. Then I will get px, okay, I will get the result of applying px operator. Okay, what it essentially means that if px has to apply on, let us say, psi, okay, which could be any function of position and time, the outcome of application of this operator will be that my result will be minus I h cross del psi del x. Now similarly, I can define an energy operator. An energy operator is defined as I h cross del del t. Okay, remember there is no negative sign. In the case of px, there was a negative sign. Okay, here there is no negative sign. So this is I h cross del del t. So it's taken as a derivative with respect to time. Like before, it implies that if E operates on psi x t, my result will be I h cross del psi del t. Now, having defined these operators, what I will do, the equation that I have just now obtained, okay, by giving some sort of logic, okay, I will rewrite that equation in the form of an operator equation. This is the equation that I obtained earlier, which I have written on the top line, okay, by taking the value of gamma and taking the second derivative of x with respect to the first derivative of time. Now I am writing this, I take 1 upon 2 m out here, then I am writing minus I h cross del del x minus I h cross del del x. Remember, square of an operator always means that you operate it twice. It does not mean that you operate and then take a square. So if I am writing p square operator, it means you first apply p x, then whatever is the outcome on that, you again apply p x on that. Okay, so I can write this as minus I h cross del del x, because these are anyway normal multiplication constants. So minus I h cross minus I h cross minus minus will give you plus, and h square, there is h square, and this I square will give you minus 1. So this is minus h square, there is 1 upon 2 m here, and once you take the derivative with respect to x, you will get del psi del x. When you take second time derivative, you get del 2 psi del x square. So this is the term which has been just written in this particular form. Here it is comparatively simpler. All I have written is I h cross del del t I have taken out, and this is operating on psi x t. Now as we have seen that this operator is px operator, this operator is also px operator. So this equation in the form of an operator can be written as 1 upon 2 m px operating again on px psi x t. And this also I can write as an energy operator. So eventually this equation which I have written earlier can be written in the form of an operator equation, which is px square by 2 m, this is the entire operator, okay, operating on psi x t is equal to energy operator applied on psi x t. So this equation has been rewritten in terms of an operator equation. Now see, remember, I want to go to a step further. This equation I have written assuming a free particle on which there is no force, but that probably is not the problem which I am going to only solve it. Eventually I have to solve problem like hydrogen atom problem or any other complicated problem, okay, in which the particle will be under the influence of a force. Okay, in that case the energy equation has to also include a potential energy. Okay, now I want to write a general equation which will also take care of those type of particles which are under the influence of a force, or they are having a potential energy function. Of course, force and potential energy, as you know, are related to each other. So now we come back to what we call as a Schrodinger equation. Now we move our consideration from a free particle to a particle under force. For such a particle, of course, you must assume that these forces are conservative forces that are of course of interest. For such a particle, the following equation would be valid: E is equal to P square by 2m V. In the case of free particle, this V was 0, and how I have obtained that particular equation was multiplying on the right hand side, or writing psi on the right hand side of both the equations, then replacing energy by its operator and replacing P square by its operator. I will do the same thing here, because in the presence of a force, this becomes my general equation, relation of energy to P square by 2m and kinetic energy and the potential energy. So what I will do, I will multiply by psi here, I will multiply by psi here, then replace E, P square and V by its, by their operators. And it so happens that the operator of V happens just to be a simple product operator. It means when V operates on psi, the resultant is just V multiplied by psi. So that makes things very, very simple. So this is what I am doing. Multiply each side by psi and replace, and remember psi has to be written on the right hand side. So probably I should not have said multiply, I should have said just write psi on the right hand side of the each of the equation, and replace their dynamical quantities by their corresponding operators. Of course, at the moment I am assuming only one dimensional case. Okay, we can generalize this equation to three dimension later. So I have just multiplied this by psi, replace E by I h cross del del t, P square by minus h square by 2m del 2 del x square, and V, as I have said, is a simple multiplication product, so operator, so this becomes V psi. Now in three dimensions you can write this equation in terms of a general operator, which is generally called a del square operator. This equation is called, this is a the general equation which is called time dependent Schrodinger equation. This is our basic equation which we believe represents the dynamics of a particular particle, or represents the behavior of a particular particle with significant wave character in that, or observable wave character in that particular thing, which is now our new equation, and we expect everything to follow this particular equation, which is the Schrodinger equation. Now, most of the time, at least not always most of the time, but at least some of the interesting type of times, at least as far as this particular part is concerned, most of the time, you will find that this potential energy is not an explicit function of time. It just depends on x, y, but it does not depend on time. It means if you are at the same position, okay, at all the time, this particular potential energy will always remain constant. Of course, if the particle changes the position, the potential energy will become different. But at the same position, it will always be remain same. If it so happens, when potential energy is not a specific function of time, then this particular equation can be written in a slightly different form, and that's what we call as a time independent Schrodinger equation. And as far as this particular course is concerned, we'll be using time independent Schrodinger equation more than the time dependent equation. So let's now come to what we call as a time independent Schrodinger equation. If the potential Vx is independent of time, it is possible to separate out the spatial and time part of the Schrodinger equation. And this is a method which we call as a method of separation of variables. This is a very, very standard method, okay, which we'll be using also later, but very, very commonly used in mathematics. So if we have to solve a particular equation which is consisting of, let's say, multiple variables, in this case, two variables, okay, we can separate this particular equation into two separate equations. For example, if it contains three variables, it may be possible to separate the equation into three different equations. This is what we call as a method of separation of variables. So what I assume in this particular thing, let's start with this assumption that I am able to write psi xt as a product of two functions. One let me call as phi, another I call as f, and let's assume that this phi is purely a function of x. It means it does not contain any time dependence. Similarly, this f function is purely a function of time. It does not contain any x term. So this is purely a function of x. This is purely a function of time. Okay, and I assume that psi for a given problem can be expressed in this particular form. Okay, if it cannot be expressed, then we will find that this is, I mean, when I substitute in this particular equation, I will find that this does not happen to be a solution. Okay, I will not be able to separate the variable out. Okay, if this happens to be a solution, then I will be able to get two different equations, one corresponding to phi, another corresponding to f, and therefore I can solve two independent equations. One of the equation will not contain time, another equation will contain only time. Okay, so let us try to do this particular trick of applying method of separation of variables and try to see whether I can get a simpler equation. Now, because I have assumed psi to be a function of phi and f, I substitute this in the Schrodinger equation, and I am again going back to the first to one dimension, because that just makes life simple. Okay, we could have done the same thing for a three-dimensional case; it would not have made any difference. Okay, so we write psi as product of two functions. This was my original Schrodinger equation. I substitute this particular thing here. So for psi, I write phi x into ft. Here also I write f x into ft. Here also write phi x into ft. So all I have done, that this psi which was appearing in the original equation, I have written a product of the two functions in place of that psi. Now let us look at this particular equation. When I take the left hand side of this equation, this is partial derivative with respect to time. It means anything which contains x has to be treated constant. This phi x contains only x, it does not contain time. So this particular thing has to be treated as a constant when I take a partial derivative with respect to time. So this phi x will come out of this particular thing. Then I have to take derivative of f with respect to time, but this term contains only f, it does not contain any x. So instead of writing partial derivative, I can write as full derivative. I can write d dt. So this is what I have done here. This ih cross is anyway here. Phi x has to be treated constant because it does not depend on time. So this I can take out here. So I have taken it out here. Then d del del t operates on f, but f is purely a function of time. So I can write is a complete derivative df dt. Similarly, I do here. Here I have del 2 psi del x square. Therefore, ft has to be treated as constant. So I take ft out. Then I have to take second derivative of phi, but this contains only x. So I can write as a full derivative d2 phi x dx square plus vx. Of course, this term remains exactly identical. Now what I do, I divide this particular thing by phi x into ft. This term by on both the sides, and of course we can say that the particle exists, the wave function cannot be zero. So phi x multiplied by ft will not be equal to zero. So I can divide both the sides by this particular term. If I divide this thing on both the sides, let us see what happens. Divide by phi x into ft. If I divide by phi x into ft, so what will happen? This phi x will cancel and you will get 1 upon ft here. So this is what is happening here. I am getting 1 upon ft here. Now similarly, if I divide this here with phi x, okay, then this phi x will cancel it out. When I divide phi x by ft, then ft will cancel it out and you will get 1 upon phi x here. And when I get phi x divide by phi x ft here, I will just get v of x. So this is what is happening here. So here I am getting h square by 2m 1 upon phi x, and then this v just remains because I have already divided by phi x and ft, so just remains vx. Now we come into a very interesting situation. This is an equation. Here on the left hand side of this particular equation, everything is only a function of time. There is nothing which depends on x. On the other hand, on the right hand side, everything is a function of x. There is nothing which depends on time. Now, for example, if time changes for the same value of x, then this term may change, but this term will not change. Or for the same time, I am looking at a different value of x, then this term will change, but this term may not change. This term will definitely not change because it is not a function of x. And if I want both these things to be always valid, then the only possibility is that this is also a constant and this is also a constant. If both the sides are equal to constant, then only it is possible to maintain this equality forever, irrespective of x, irrespective of time. So I can write this particular equation as this particular thing has to be constant, which I am writing as E, and this particular thing also obviously has to be equal to the same constant because this has to be maintained equal to this. So this equation has now been separated out into two different equations. One of this equation contains only time, another equation contains only x. Okay, so I can sort of solve this equation separately. Now remember, this has been possible only because X did not contain V, potential energy did not contain the time part. If it had contained time part explicitly, then I could not have separated this equation, because this particular part on the right hand side would have contained a time dependent part, nor I could have put this V here, because then it would have contained a X part. Okay? Then it would not have been possible for us to separate out this equation. This separation has been possible because we have assumed that V is only a function of X and is not a function of time. Okay? In that case, I have been able to solve these two equations. Now, one thing which is very interesting, that this particular solution of this particular equation, this equation, there is no V term. When I go from one problem to another problem, what is likely to change is only the potential energy. Okay? The force under which the particle is moving, that is the one which is likely to change, and therefore V of X is likely to change. What is interesting in this thing, that as far as the solution of the first equation is concerned, this will always remain same. It is not dependent on Vx. It is only this particular equation which is dependent on Vx, and this will be different. The solution of this particular part, phi, will be different for different problem. Okay? But so long Vx is only a function of X, its time dependent part will always be identical, which will be just a solution of this particular equation. Now, let us try to first solve this equation, which is a very, very simple equation to solve, as all of you know, this is a standard differential equation. So, let us solve this particular equation. Let us write this equation in this particular form. And when I write this particular equation in this particular form, I can just solve this equation. It's an exponential solution. So, Ft will be of the form A e raised to the power minus I upon h cross times time t. And this is an always an equation, I mean, whenever this particular thing will always be constant irrespective of whatever is the potential energy. Now, I want to make sort of a strong statement here, I hope all of you would agree, that if this equation is a general equation, then this should also be valid for a free particle, and for a free particle, I know that the solution is to be written in the form of psi. Kx minus omega t. Now, as we have said that omega is equal to, is going to be h cross omega is going to be e. So, this omega has to be written as e upon h cross, where e is energy. All right. So, now I know that time dependent part is of this particular thing is e raised to power minus I e by h cross time. And as I said, this particular time dependent part does not depend on phi. Therefore, what appears here as E or what appeared as a constant in that particular equation can be identified as the energy of the particle. So, this energy of the particle, because this is what comes in the case of free particle. So, when I compare this particular thing with the free particle, I can identify this particular constant E as the energy. So, that is what I have done in that particular equation. Comparing with the standard wave equation, we interpret E as the energy of the particle. Now, what remains is the second equation, which is what I have written here, and this is what you call as time independent Schrodinger equation. Remember, the solution of this particular equation can be real, because phi here, there is no I here. So, the solution of phi, this equation, may yield you a value of phi which is always real. But you must always remember that actual wave function, okay, is this multiplied by e raised to power minus I e t by h cross. There are many problems in which this particular term will not matter, which I will be discussing later. Okay? But if you want to write a general wave function, general solution of this particular equation, the general solution is always of the form phi x into e raised to power minus I e t by h cross, which always will make the wave function complex. Though solution of time independent Schrodinger equation can be real, but overall wave function will always be complex. So, this is my time dependent Schrodinger equation, which I am writing in this particular form. This is a three-dimensional form. So, when you are writing in this particular form, where this is a del square operator, which is given by del 2 psi del x square plus del 2 psi del y square plus del 2 psi del z square. Now, of course, there is an advantage that if you are not using r theta phi, I mean, if you are not using Cartesian coordinates, x, y, z coordinates, but you are using r theta phi coordinates, in that case, we can correspondingly change del square operator by its value in any other coordinate system. This is my time independent Schrodinger equation. And remember, when v is purely a function of x, psi xt is phi x into e raised to the power minus I t by h cross. So, we have obtained the equation. Now, let us try to see what can we do with these equations. See, unlike what I am going to do in relativity, here I am not going to give the postulates of quantum mechanics immediately, because they are, as I said, fairly abstract, complex. So, what I will be keeping on doing will be introducing these concepts one by one, slowly and slowly. I mean, this is what I have found is quite helpful when I am dealing with the students, because you do not give them a big shock right in the beginning. You start slowly and slowly exposing them to more and more complex ideas. So, then students are able to take these concepts somewhat easily. Okay. So, now we will start talking about this, what is this psi. Once I have got an equation, suppose I know what is the value of v of x and I have solved this equation and I have obtained this value of phi and hence I have obtained the value of psi. What I am going to do with this particular thing? How do I physically interpret? Okay. Remember, the psi is what we are saying is the wave which is associated with this particular particle. Now, we have also said that this wave is not a realistic, I mean, in that sense, is a sort of a complex wave. Okay. So, in that sense, it is not very easy. I mean, see, it's so different from the normal waves that we are used to it. The normal waves, like, you know, let us say water waves, or for that matter, sound waves, or electromagnetic waves, where we can really think of something which is real, which is being associated with these particular things. While in this case, whatever we are talking is a complex space. This wave function or wave which is representing the particle is having some sort of complex behavior, but the outcome, the wave I am going to use this equation, okay, must provide me something which has to be real so that it has a physical meaning. Now, let us first try to give an interpretation of what is this psi. What does this psi represent? Okay, this particular wave, what does eventually it represents? And as some of you had already pointed out in the morning, this does represent the probability. So, let us try to understand this wave function, which is actually not, again, all that very simply understood. So, I am trying to give some example to make things somewhat clearer. I have written in a form of sort of a postulate, but, you know, as I said, all the postulates I will sort of, I mean, not all the postulates, as quantum mechanics we keep on developing, you find that many more postulates are coming out. They are not as clean as, for example, Newton's laws. When you see Newton's first law, second law, third law, okay, everyone understand what is first law, what is second law. Similarly, when you talk about the postulates of special theory of relativity, which we will talk, first postulate, second postulate, everyone understand it. But here in the case of quantum mechanics, they are sort of mixed up. So, we are talking of one of the postulates of quantum mechanics, which says that a microscopic particle is described by a wave function, okay, which you can think of a wave associated with the particle. And we assume that this contains all the information that we can have about the physical properties of the particle. So, all that you can obtain about a particular particle is its wave function. That is going to contain all the information. All the information that you want about the dynamical properties of this particular particle is contained in that particular wave function. This is all that you can obtain, and only from this particular wave function you have to extract appropriate things. How do we abstract? That's what we are going to discuss in our subsequent lectures. The Schrodinger equation gives the position and the time dependence of the wave function. So, how do I obtain the wave function? Okay, solve Schrodinger equation. First, we say, this postulate says that there is something called wave function which contains all the information about the particle, and this Schrodinger equation has to be solved in order to obtain this particular wave function. So, the second statement says that how to obtain this wave function. You obtain it by solving Schrodinger equation. Then, next thing that we say, that probability of finding the, I am again switching back to one dimension, because one dimension is rather easy for us to understand, especially it is much easier to make it understand to students. As I say, we want to introduce complexity slowly rather than talking of all the complexity right in the first go. So, the probability of finding the particle between x and x plus dx is given by psi x t square. It means psi star psi dx. See, I hope this is clear, that when we are talking, this essentially means psi star xt multiplied by psi xt. This is what I mean by psi square. So, we take the complex conjugate of psi, multiplied by it, obviously you will get something which is real, but because any complex number. If you take complex conjugate and multiply, you will always get real number. So this particular thing will always be real. This will tell me what is the probability of obtaining the particle between x and x plus dx. What does this probability mean? Let's first understand what does this probability mean. So let's define this probability. It's exceedingly important to understand this thing very properly. Imagine a very large number of separate identical particles described by the same wave function. So you assume that there are very large number of particles described by the wave function psi xt. Okay? Remember somebody had asked in the morning also that can we talk of a single particle? Of course, we talk of the single particle wave function. But if I want to look at the probabilistic character, I have to have a large number of systems. All right? So let's assume that we have very large number of separate identical particles and all of them are described by exactly the same wave function psi xt. If a measurement of position is done on all of them at the same time t, this particular probability means that the result will not be identical. That's what is important. For example, if we are sure that they will all be at one point, okay, then the probability is 1. For example, if we toss a coin and we are sure that I am always going to get head, then the probability of obtaining head is 1. But if I do, let's say, 1000 measurements, then sometimes I will get head, sometimes I will get tail. Okay, this is just to draw a parallelism. Okay, similarly, if there is a probability associated with the particular of particle being found at a particular value of x, then very, very large number of particles, I try to locate the position of that particular particle at a given time, then I will find that the results are not identical. If the probability of finding the particle, let's say between x0 and x1 is 0.1, it means then in 10% of measurement, the position of the particle would be found between x0 and x1. In 90% of the measurements on the average, you will not find the particles to be lying between x0 and x1. So you have a particle, you have multiple particles, okay, and on multiple particles, you make the measurement exactly at the same time, find out what is the location of the particle, and when you find out the location of the particle, you find that in 10% of the measurement, the particle will be found between x0 and x1 if the probability of finding the particle is 0.1 between x0 and x1. See, what is important to realize that this probability does not talk of making measurement on the same particle at a different time. This is very, very important to realize. The probability is not defined over a measurement on a single particle. Suppose a measurement was made at a time and the particle was found to be very, very close to x0. Okay? If we make immediately a second measurement, remember the word important is immediately, it will still be found there. It's not that if I make a measurement of particle and find the particle here, okay, let's say I find the particular particle here, then immediately after that I make the measurement, I will find particle somewhere here. Then there is no meaning of experimental reproducibility. It means, what is the experiment? Sometimes I make a measurement here and immediately I make next measurement, particle is somewhere else. Remember, probability does not talk about it. When we are talking about the quantum mechanical probability, it does not talk about measurements being done on the same particle. Okay, they are a very large number of identical particles and these measurements are being done on different particles described by the same wave function. That's what is most important aspect of this particular probability. I'll give you more examples in our later classes to make this particular thing very, very explicit. So let me read it again. Defined over a measurement on a single particle. The probability is not defined over a measurement on a single particle. Suppose a measurement was made at a time t and the particle was found to be in the close vicinity of x0, if we make a measurement immediately afterward, it will still be found there. Experimental reproducibility is necessary. Of course, at a much later time, the wave function may again evolve under the Schrodinger equation, and then of course it may change its position. Okay, so the word what was important was immediately. Okay, okay, at a later time, if you leave the particle for another 10 seconds or 10 minutes, okay, the particle may again change its position and may again evolve under the Schrodinger equation. Okay, but if we make the measurement immediately after that, I must find the particle there itself. Measurement on different particles at the same time, however, may not yield the same result. When I'm making measurements on different particles, then I do not get the same result. That's what is important and that's what is inherent in this particular probability. So I think I'll stop here. I mean, our time is over 4:30. If there are some questions, I can sort of answer now. You can post your questions. Okay, of course, the centers we have where there is no question, if they want, they can leave it, there is no problem. We'll take for another 5-10 minutes some questions and then.
Dronacharya College.
Yes, please tell your question.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, I have question. I have two questions, sir. First question is,
yeah,
in intensity will increase or decrease?
Yes.
If it will decrease, is it true, sir?
No. See, thing is that, you know, intensity. Hello? As I said, I mean, psi square. Yes. I mean, I presume you are talking of the wave function. Then of course psi square represents the intensity, and it is this intensity which is proportional to the probability. All right. So a larger intensity means a larger probability of finding the particle there. I'm not sure whether I have understood your question and whether I have answered your question.
It is able to find the intensity losses during interference.
See, I do not mean what do you mean by intensity losses. See, when you are talking of interference and you are, say, finding out at some place intensity to be low, it means the probability of finding particle there is low. If there is certain point where you are finding the intensity to be large, it means the probability of finding particle there is large. I mean, this is what I have been mentioning also when we are talking about the interference experiments.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
PSG College.
In the case of electromagnetic waves.
Yes.
Is there an interference in dispersive media?
Well, I mean, most of the media that we are trying to see are, you know, partly dispersive. Okay, I mean, it's not really, we are never performing experiments in non-dispersive media. But of course, depends on what is the dielectric constant, things like that. I think Professor Ghosh is going to talk about electromagnetic waves a little bit more in general. Okay, at that time, you can raise this question about, you know, what happens when there is a media.
Okay, so in the case of matter waves,
yes,
do you think the wavelength or whatever changes with the medium, does the medium matter for a matter wave?
See, as far as the Schrodinger equation is concerned, you know, there is no, I mean, effect of media in that sense, because see, this does not depend, you know, on the dielectric constant of the medium or the permittivity or permeability of the medium. So, at least I do not see any way how does it matter. See, the media may change, alter its momentum, therefore the de Broglie wavelength may change. Okay, let me put it like that. If you want to really draw a parallelism of media, which we normally draw in the case of particle wave, it's only in terms of the potential energy. Okay, if you talk of a medium in its electromagnetic wave, the closest parallel to that particular thing in the case of matter wave is when a particular particle moves from one potential to another potential. So, like a step potential, you know, example of some of which we will give later. Okay, that probably mimics the media most accurately. In that case, if you talk of that type of media where potential energies are different, okay, of course, the wave equation will get affected, the kinetic energy, the energy will get affected, the probabilities will get affected. Okay, so so long we take of that parallelism of medium, I think, okay, it does depend on media. But if you are talking of medium like let's say air or water, okay, that has a totally different connotation as far as quantum mechanics is concerned.
It doesn't matter.
So, I'm saying, so if, as far as kinetic energy is concerned, it depends on whatever the forces that are experiencing. See, it's almost, the media matters almost exactly the same way. For example, if you fire a bullet inside the water, okay, what will happen to the bullet?
Yeah.
Okay, so it's basically interacting with whatever are the forces there. So, whatever are the forces as far as this particular particle is concerned, they have to be mimicked. All right, so media will matter so long we can actually find out what, in what way this particular media changes the potential energy of the particle. All right?
Yeah. So, if you take a complex representation.
Yes.
For a wave function.
Yes, right.
So, but we don't find any analogous in a real picture, right?
You can find any?
Is it only for a mathematical?
It's, yes, that's right.
So, it is only for a mathematical convenience in that sense?
That's right.
We don't lose any generality, but still we could get some physics out of it.
That's right. See, the thing is that, you know, if you want to really talk about the wave function, it does represent a probability wave in a sort of a complex medium. Okay, but this particular method can be used to derive something which is realistic about this thing. As probably all of you would be knowing, because I'm sure you at some level you would have done an advanced quantum mechanics course, it's not really necessary to talk about the wave mechanics. We can also approach quantum mechanics in a totally different fashion by using totally operators. Okay, but to introduce them to first year students is not all that simple. So, I am sort of avoiding, because I am sort of trying to talk at a level which we can actually explain to the first year students. In that case, you know, we are not talking about that aspect, we are still talking about the wave aspect. So, this particular complex thing which we have introduced as a complex wave pattern, okay, which yields us some realistic results, okay, need not be present, at least in some problems you can do totally in a different fashion and obtain the same results of the, you know, whatever dynamical quantities we are interested in.
Okay. But there is no approximation in such case, that we take only the real part, right?
No, you see, we are not taking real part. So, see, for every quantity that we are measuring, we have to find a method how I evolve that particular information using this particular wave function, which we'll describe later when we're talking about these things. Okay, I'm not taking a real part. It's unlike that, you know. See, for example, when I'm taking probability, I'm not taking the real part. I'm taking complex conjugate and multiplying by it. Okay, so it's unlike the circuit analysis where we are used to taking only the real part. It is not that circuit analysis type. We are, for once we have obtained wave function, how do I obtain realistic information? For that, we have to have a postulate. And all that I have told at this particular moment is the postulate of finding the probability. Okay, and that is not taking by taking real part, but by taking a complex conjugate and multiplying by that.
That's okay. But the system, the real system is represented by a real part alone, right? What is the role of the complex part
That's the only way I can describe the wave function. I mean, that's the only way I can talk about the wave nature of the particle. Okay, there is no other way of talking about it. You know, I cannot draw a parallelism with a realistic system because, you know, the system, the realistic system is a particle which has a significant wave character.
What happens if the forces are not conservative in the case of quantum?
Well, that's a little more difficult problem, you know, because I'm not very sure whether this can be done in a very simple fashion of the quantum mechanics. I'm not very familiar with, you know, if you're talking, the thing is that the level at which the quantum mechanics is applicable, okay, see, we are not going to solve a problem of a block moving on an inclined plane and introduce things like friction which have non-conservative forces. Okay, I'm going to talk at a much more atomic level, where, I mean, I don't see immediately a sort of a non-conservative force in that sense.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome. Probably we'll go to two more questions.
Vanariyaman.
Hello, sir. Sir, what are canonically conjugate variables, sir?
What are?
Which is used in canonically conjugate variables.
See, I'm not very sure what you actually mean. I mean, when we are talking of conjugate variables, we talk of only those variables amongst which there is a uncertainty principle exists. For example, X and PX. Okay, I hope that's what you mean. Okay, or let's say energy and time, or angle and angular momentum. So these are sort of conjugate variables, okay, amongst which a uncertainty principle exists.
The same quantities are evolved from classical mechanics from Poisson brackets.
That's correct. That's right. In fact, you know, when you're talking about the quantum mechanical aspects, many of these things, the concept of Hamiltonian, etc., all those things have actually come from the traditional classical mechanics, which have now been sort of expanded to include in the quantum mechanics. Yes, you are right.
So I just want to know what is the special about only energy and time, position and momentum. And
thing is that eventually if you take a commutation relation, it does not, they do not commute with respect to each other. That's how, you know, that we eventually come to the uncertainty principle. But, you know, I don't want to introduce these things right at this particular level because, you know, that's much beyond the scope of this particular course.
Okay. Sir, can we say that light photon is less localized compared to X-ray photon since its wavelength is shorter?
No. See, what is its localized depends on the conditions. What are the conditions that's going to be put in? You know, it does not depend on what is the wavelength. Okay, what type of condition that you are letting it go through? Okay, the localization depends basically on that particular aspect. It essentially depends. I mean, the wave function localization also depends on the boundary conditions.
Because the particle nature of microwaves, radios, the long wavelength radiations are never any practical examples are not there. That's why I'm asking.
No. See, things that
localization link.
See, you are right. The wavelength is very large there. Okay, but still, as I say, I do not immediately see a role of the wavelength being there. I mean, see, what it could mean that the probability may be constant or whatever it is. But, you know, eventually the determination of the wave packet or the length of the wave packet will depend on the type of the boundary condition that you are applying. So eventually, if you are looking at waveguide. Okay, you are putting them putting their microwaves inside a waveguide. It's the waveguide which is sort of localizing the electromagnetic waves.
Okay, thank you.
Gandhi Institute.
Sir, do you get any idea of quantization of mass from quantum mechanics?
Well, I at least I am not aware of it. because I'm definitely not aware of any quantization of mass type of.
Because we're talking about particle nature.
I mean,
of light.
In a sense, you can always talk that there are certain fundamental particles, and you do not know how to divide those particular particles. So in that sense, you can talk if you want about quantization of mass. But I do not think that's a part of any quantum mechanical aspects. At least I'm not aware. Of course, the massive particle, you know, probably a result of particle physics, about which I'm not aware personally. That's not my area. So how the masses of these particular particles come in and things like that, that I'm not I'm definitely not familiar with that particular thing.
Okay. Thank you. Sir, one more question.
Yeah.
Why do we get the application of time-dependent Schrodinger equations?
See, for example, when we are talking of transitions, etc., at different levels, then we talk of the time-dependent perturbation theory. So we do talk of time dependence. Okay, for example, whenever there are things which depends on time, for example, a typical example which I have given is transition. If a particular atom has gone to an excited state and it sort of emits a photon and comes back to the ground state, or a photon gets absorbed and it goes to excited state, all this becomes a part of the time-dependent Schrodinger equation.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you. So we are closing now, and if you have any questions, please do post it, and we'll try to answer. And all I want to say that because we are getting large number of questions, so we'll be able to answer only those questions which are really pertinent to the type of lectures that we are giving here. Thank you.